Symptom management is an interesting term. I think that what we really are talking about is patients who require palliative care earlier in their disease process. Because the term palliative care can be very scary to patients, when they hear that, they think that the jig is up, they're going to die within hours to days. We tend to say, well, we look after pain and symptoms for patients, even though it truly is the same principles and the same practice of palliative care. So, and a good example, a person comes in, they have pain secondary to their disease, or maybe secondary to the treatment. You know, sometimes we cure cancers, but we leave people with debilitating symptoms such as pain. Pain is probably the biggest one that I can think of right now. So bringing patients back and sitting them down and saying, okay, this is the situation that we have right now. How can we address this? What is the pain that we're looking at? Give me some more characteristics of it. Let's look at medications that can help it. If not medications, what can we do as adjuvant type of processes? Would massage help? Would heat help? Would it mean that we might need to use injections to get that pain under control? And when we look at that, especially patients that are, let's say, cured, trying to build that into their life, there's a challenge there. And I know that some patients have said to me, well, if I knew this when I signed up, I would never have signed up. And you know, I find that quite profound, because we've just cured cancer for you. How can you say that, you know, if you knew this, you wouldn't want your cancer cured? But yet, obviously, that symptom, that pain, is having a huge impact upon their life. In doing that, in helping them to progress on with life despite cancer, we're looking at different ways that can be acceptable to them. So some people say, I'm not a pill taker, I don't want to take pills. Well, how else can we do it? Well, we can use topical medications, for instance. We can use patches if the pain is responsive to that. We can look at some of those physical modalities, like I said, massage, acupuncture, acupressure. Some people feel that alternative, you know, complementary and alternative methods work very well for them. And I'm pretty open to all of that. I'm really trying to focus in on the patient themselves. What can we do for that patient? Like, you know, think of it as going to a smorgasbord. I open the restaurant, I say, here's the smorgasbord, what's going to work really well for you? And we can try out different things over time. Sometimes I can see right from the beginning it's not going to work. The patient is, let's say, non-compliant, isn't really wanting to be there. Sometimes we have to work on psychosocial issues first. Sometimes it's finances. You know, it's an interesting thought that in Canada, with our medical program and Medicare that we're talking about, there are still people who can't afford certain things. They can't afford the medication, or they can't afford to go see a massage therapist. Especially those people after cancer, many times they lose their jobs. And so they're cured, but how do they go back? They sometimes can't go back to the same job. They've lost feeling in their fingers and toes. So sometimes you have to work around that and try to find some alternatives for them. And that's a challenge. That can be a real challenge, but it's a good challenge. You know, something that I can say, okay, what do we do to make it better for this person or that person? I think it's really important for doctors, nurses, anyone involved in cancer care to broaden the focus. I think it's good to look at some of the psychosocial experts that we have, the social workers, counselors, psychologists, who deal with a lot of the emotional and psychosocial effects of cancer and their impact upon life. And they see these sorts of things, because people will say, well, you know, I can't be intimate anymore, or I'm scared coming into the cancer center. We don't hear that enough. And because of that, often we say, hey, we cured your cancer. That's great. You're feeling good. See ya. Bye-bye. And yet there's so many loose threads, if you will. And once you start pulling at those loose threads, you realize that there's a whole bunch more behind it. And I think it's really important, like when a patient comes in to see us in our clinic, they have to fill in, or we ask them to fill in a sheet that tells us, you know, how are their symptoms today? What's the intensity of their symptoms? What sort of fears or issues they're having? And those issues look at various domains. They're not just fear, but they also look at intimacy, finances, are you depressed, you know, are you having difficulty with this or that. So it's called a distress form. We call it Compass in Winnipeg. But it helps out a lot because at a single glance for me, suddenly I see, okay, pain, nausea, they're not sleeping very well, they're worried about intimacy, they don't have finances. These are things that are really important. So that becomes a tool for us to broaden that scope. And that's one of the things that I think is very important when we're talking about palliative care or pain and symptom, that we keep in mind that there's a whole number of things out there. It's not just, oh, they've got pain, let's fix the pain. But then what about that depression? Or what about their shortness of breath? Because sometimes fixing one will fix the others, but if you don't address that, then patients sometimes feel very left out. Well, you know, I've been here, I've been telling you about this for such a long time, you haven't done anything about it. And when we see that, we see patients who were referred after months or weeks of complaining to their doctor, you know, I fill in this form, you don't do anything about it. And again, you know, the focus for many professionals is let's just fix that cancer. So they forget about everything else.